Het Zuid-Afrika-huis. Het cultuur- en kenniscentrum voor uitwisseling van cultuur, taal en geschiedenis over Zuid-Afrika. Dit doen we met onze collecties, taalkursussen en evenementen. Vandaag introduceren wij Boeken uit het Huis. Een samenwerking tussen de Taalunie en het Zuid-Afrika-huis. Welkom op de livestream van het Zuid-Afrika-huis.
Dames en heren, ik heet u van harte welkom bij de 4e aflevering van Boeken uit het Huis. Vanmiddag hebben we twee hele bijzondere gasten. De Zuid-Afrikaanse Ronelle Kamfer en haar Nederlandse vertaler Alfred Schaffer. En Alfred is als docent verbonden aan de Universiteit van Stellenbosch. Hij is tevens vertaler uiteraard en bovenal zelf ook dichter. En winnaar van de PC Hoofdprijs 2021. Ronelda en Alfred zullen in gesprek gaan over Ronelda's nieuwe bundel Chinatown. En die is in maart bij uitgeverij Podium verschenen in een prachtige tweetalige Afrikaans en Nederlandse editie. Ronelda Kamfer werd geboren in 1981 in Blackheath, een voorstad van Kaapstad. Ze debuteerde in 2003 met twee gedichten in de door Ankie Krog en Alfred Schaffer samengestelde bloemlezing Nieuwe Stemmen 3. In 2008 verscheen Ronelda's debuutbundel Nou dat slapende honden, waarvoor ze in 2009 de Eugène Maret-prijs ontving. En in 2010 was Ronelda honneursstudent aan de Universiteit van West-Kaapland, waar Ankie Krog een van haar professoren was. En in 2011 verscheen Ronelda's tweede bundel, Grond Santekraam. In 2016 Hammy en vorig jaar in 2020 dus Chinatown. En alle vier de bundels zijn door Alfred Schaffer in het Nederlands vertaald. De media-aandacht voor de Nederlandse vertaling van Chinatown was overdonderend de afgelopen weken, maanden. Met grote interviews, Parool en de Poëziekrant. Het dichter Erik-Jan Harmens noemde het boek de poëziebelevenis van dit jaar tot nu toe. En Tom Lanois had het over een must voor al wie houdt van zustertalen en straffe verzen. Ronelda is getrouwd met dichter, illustrator, striptekenaar en schrijver Nathan Trantraal. En samen hebben ze een dochter, Seymour. Ronelda en Alfred samen worden vanmiddag geïnterviewd door Ama van Danzig, een sociaal ondernemer en een van de oprichters van innovatiestudio Dr. Monk. Ik zou u willen aanbevelen om op de website te gaan kijken. Heel inspirerend. U bent van ons gewend dat het gesprek in het Afrikaans en het Nederlands plaatsvindt. Het is volgens het zogeheten principe van luistertaal. Dat we elkaar altijd zouden kunnen verstaan als Nederlands sprekende en Afrikaans sprekende. Vandaag wijken we hier een ietsje van af en zullen we in drie talen praten. Afrikaans, Nederlands en Engels. Ama, Ronelda en Alfred, aan jullie het woord.
Dankjewel voor deze mooie introductie. En het is echt heel fijn om al deze bio's bij elkaar te horen. Vooral, ik bedoel, van Ronelda en van Alfred. Want dan zie je hoe belangrijk het is om jezelf te omringen met creatieve mensen, met kunstenaars. En hoe nurturing dat kan zijn als creatief geest. Dus super. Mooi en wat een eer om dit te mogen doen. Ik ga dit verder doen in het Engels. I'm going to continue in English because that's what Ronelda and I discussed. And we thought, you know, we all speak so many languages. Let's show off. Let's make it more complicated. Let's speak and English because we like complicated things. So, Ronelda, we are living in very complicated times, where we have big dreams that take place outside, sometimes in outer space, sometimes in other universes, but we are all stuck inside in our homes. We can't go anywhere. And we've all been so creative surviving, you know, navigating these spaces. I wanted to start by welcoming you to this wonderful gathering where you are across the ocean somewhere far away in South Africa, in Makanda, it's called. And we are in grey, wet, cold Netherlands, where Alfred thinks it's summer. He's so wrong. I wonder how has the last year and a half been for you, Ronelda? What are some of the things that have stood out for you as a creative person the last year and a half?
I think that for me it is. I think I've experienced it the same as everyone else. Just very confused. We don't really know what the world is turning into and what is really, really happening. I think that as a creative person, when the pandemic started, that's like the last thing that I wanted to do was be creative. I think that it was such a scary and uncertain time for everyone. And so for me, I think that I only sort of started processing, you know, things as an artist a few months later. I think that one thing that many people don't know about me, especially in the Netherlands, is I used to be a nurse for a very brief, you know, brief period in my life. So when the pandemic started, the thing that hit me the most was all the friends and people that I knew that was working in healthcare and the concerns and how stressful that was for them. And then obviously the implications, the economic implications of lockdowns and, you know, in a country where people are already living in poverty. And yeah, it was just, for me, it was a strange kind of space to exist in. And, you know, and I was, when in the beginning of last year, I was working on my, on another book, and I was sort of focused on that, and I didn't really want to do anything else, you know, and it was nice because I had a deadline, and so you kind of push to do that, and you're forced to focus on one thing. But the truth is, you know, I just felt, you know, helpless and you know, worried and concerned for family all over the country and people in general. So one thing I realized about creatives is that the pandemic has sort of exposed a lot of people and personalities. And I think that the one thing that really struck me was the moment the pandemic hit, the lockdowns hit, everybody was talking on social media of, you know, finding a new way to how do we work now. And that was the main concern, and that just made me so angry. It's like, this is your concern, is, you know, how can we commodify this and make money out of this, and sort of part of me was felt that way. But the other part is also, is like, the arts were already struggling, especially in South Africa, and, you know, artists needed to work and to earn. So it's a very sort of complicated argument, you know. Yeah. And these are the things that were sort of stuck in my head for a very long time.
But it sounds like this was, you know, very much the beginning of the setting, and it's so interesting to listen to you having made this move from being a nurse, so really being in the care sector, to being in the creative sector. It's an interesting move to confront yourself with in crisis. But I understood that you and your husband, Nathan, you made a series of portraits. Could you tell us a little bit about this? And perhaps maybe we can be looking at this as you're telling us about. Could you tell us, you know, what is it about? What did you create? And maybe as you're telling us, you can add also, what is it like working with your partner? I don't know if we can all identify with if this is good for all our relationships.
No, I think that so when we, like I said, I had lots of people I knew who worked in the healthcare industry, and someone very, very close to me, I think it was in May or July or June last year, I got the news that she has passed away from COVID. And that affected me so sort of profoundly that I just wanted to somehow express where my mind was at. And so it started from wanting to to make, you know, create something as in memory of her, to realizing that there's a lot more we can sort of say about this, and also having family in Cape Town and struggling, you know, my nephew can't go to school, and just how complicated things were, and listening to my sister speaking about how difficult it has become for her, because she had a part-time job and now she's out of work, and all of these things sort of I wanted to express this in a way where I wanted people to understand that while we are all trying to survive, you know, to think about each other, and so the portrait series was just a way to kind of make people stop and think that, you know, that how this is really affecting other people as well as it is affecting you. And as for like working with my partner, it's sort of normal to us because we are both writers, and he edits my work and I edit his, and I have no you know special recipe or advice or knowledge. You know, I think that we in life we just learn and you kind of just make things up as you go along, so I'm always like very scared to answer questions like that because it might sound like I know things that, you know, that somehow this works better because I know something that other people don't, but I don't know anything. I mean, we just, you know, we are able to, and so that works.
So how did you have this division of roles between you and Nathan?
Well, because it was, I wanted to do a comic strip with him, and I wanted to write things, but I'm too serious to write anything funny. And he's always like, no, your jokes are too dark. You can't make a strip, you know, it's not going to work. No one's going to laugh. And so this was a perfect opportunity for me to be serious and have him draw these characters without, you know, having that idea. So it's sort of a good compromise for me, not being, you know, being funny enough for a comic strip, but, you know, somehow made it work.
Yeah. So you got to keep it real and stay your dark humored self. And he added some lightheartedness. And,
yeah, he just added the images. Yeah.
Yeah. The people in these portraits, are they all real people, or did you make them up?
Well, it's obviously influenced by real people and stories, but most of it is just characters that he designed and sort of we made up as. Because it does feel it would be uncomfortable for me to actually draw people that I knew and not ask them their permission to use their. So it was more of a general sort of social commentary about different kind and based on real sort of real experiences.
And does do you see any, do you as a creator see any styles of like manga in this portrait?
Well, because that is Nathan's sort of drawing style, and I'm always, you know, I want him to draw things that are realistically looking, so you know, I'm on that end of the spectrum, and he's sort of, no, it has to be artistic, it has to be in this style, and I don't know anything about style or about drawing styles, so that was also, so he could use his sensibilities of the colors and that, and I could have my sort of, my more serious, you know, looking, you know, deadpan looking characters that just look straight into the, you know, sort of straight into the camera type thing.
Really, really cool. I really enjoyed looking at this, and I think it's such a beautiful way to remember your friend. I think so many people have lost so much in the last year and a half, and sometimes laughing about it, whether it's dark or light humor, it's a way of dealing with such a huge loss that we are experiencing globally. And it seems like you and your partner found a really special way to make a monument, to make a memory of this loss. Could you tell us where could we see it? I think we are already seeing it now, but if we would want to look back at it, read it.
We did it for an online publication called the Freya Weekblad. So you can Google it there online, and it should still be there. The entire series is on their site.
Okay, really, really, really great. I really enjoyed seeing these, and I am really impressed with you and your partner that you are able to so naturally collaborate. It doesn't come so naturally to everybody, but I'm also really impressed with you and how you've managed to surround yourself with so many talented and nurturing creatives. I can imagine that's how something this as special as Chinatown comes to be. But I'll reserve that for now, because I wanted us to go change languages. I want people to understand that I speak different languages. So we're now going to talk to somebody who is also very special to you and who has been introduced by Anjali already, Alfred Schaffer, who is in South Africa with you, not in the same town though. You're in Stellenbosch, right?
Yes.
Yes. We gaan nu Nederlands praten. Als je wil, mag je terugpraten in het Zuid-Afrikaans. In het Afrikaans, maar ik versta je dan niet, dus dat is misschien.
Ja, dan kunnen we dat
misschien
maar niet
versta
doen,
ik je wel, maar dan. Hè?
Doe het gewoon in het Nederlands. Ja.
Gewoon in het Nederlands, hè? Oké, dan. Want Alfred, jij kent Ronelde al heel lang.
Ja, maar ik weet nou niet hoe lang eigenlijk, dat je het vraagt.
Ja.
Maar ontzettend. Ja, ik weet soms ook niet welke taal ik nou spreek. Volgens mij was dit dan weer Afrikaans. Maar het was met Nieuwe Stemmen 3 dat ik samen met Ankie Kroch samenstelde. Dat was zo'n soort uitgave waarin ruimte wordt gegeven aan nieuwe talenten in Afrikaanse poëzie. Dus nog ongepubliceerde dichters. En die krijgen dan de ruimte om 5 of 6 of 8 gedichten te publiceren. Die worden geselecteerd door 2 redacteuren. In dat geval was dus Ankie en ik. En toen kwamen op die natuurlijk nog anonieme gedichten van Ronelde Kamphen, want de naam wordt dan afgeplakt. Niet dat, ja, ze was er nog niet bekend, dus we hadden toch niet geweten wie het was. Maar het was wel gelijk heel erg opvallend. Onder andere het gedicht Kaki Goes With Everything. Dat is ook zo'n gedicht, lang gedicht dat in haar debuut staat. En ik vond het gelijk fantastisch. En Ankie, die ik nog meer weet als Zuid-Afrikaans, zegt gelijk, maar dit is een hele aparte stem. Dit is niet zomaar gewoon goede poëzie, maar hier wordt ook iets echt ontgonnen dat nog niet, of heel lang geleden, of door andere dichters, maar nog heel weinig in elk geval ontgonnen is in het Afrikaans. Dus we waren er gelijk helemaal weg van. En ja, dat boek 2004 of zo was het, of 2003.
En dat is het eerste wat je van haar hebt gelezen?
Dat was het eerste. En ja. Dat is dus nu bijna 16 jaar geleden, denk ik. Doe het uit mijn hoofd. En we hebben toen ook nog een workshop gegeven, weet ik, in Johannesburg. Maar ik weet helemaal niet meer wie daarbij waren eigenlijk. Dat is al zo lang geleden.
The workshop we were was the one in town.
Was je bij die workshop? Was je daar?
Ik was. Dat was hier in de Kaap. It was by a weird, want ik het niet geweten wie is Alfred en Ankie. Obviously, you know, my team where I was in. So, ik kan niet geloven, het was al zo lang geleden, maar ja, dat was de eerste keer wat ik soort van published was. En dat is waar ik voor Alfred ontmoet heb.
Ja, dat was de eerste keer, dat is lang geleden, ja.
Super, maar dat heeft echt indruk gemaakt op jou, Alfred.
Ja, sowieso om daarbij betrokken te zijn. Ik ben ook maar gewoon een Nederlander die hier rondliep. En opeens werd ik gevraagd om zo'n boek met Ankie ook nog samen te stellen. Ik bedoel, ik wist niet wie Alfred was. Ik wist ook niet wie ik was, bij wijze van spreken. Dus het was voor mij ook een hele grote eer natuurlijk om dat te doen. Dus om dan ook nog toch wel poëzie te lezen die ik nog niet kende. En niet, ik bedoel niet in de zin dat ik die gedichten van die dichters nog niet gelezen had, maar nou specifiek van Ronelde, dat soort poëzie had ik nog niet zoveel gelezen, of niet gelezen. ja, was echt wel een zo'n stoot tussen je ogen, weet je wel.
Yeah.
En toen kwam dat de buurt uit. Ja, het was heel direct. Het was heel inhoudelijk. Dus het ging over dingen. Het ging over thema's die spelen in deze Zuid-Afrikaanse context. Maar het was ook heel ambachtelijk en gewoon hele goede poëzie ook. Dus het was niet alleen maar pamfletistisch en ik ga het nu over iets hebben. Maar het zat ook heel goed in elkaar. Het was ook grappig, maar dan op een hele confronterende manier grappig. Dat ze echt heeft uitgebouwd, vind ik, in die bundels daarna. Dus het is nog ambivalenter geworden wat mij betreft, haar werk. Waardoor je, Nathan's werk is wat dat betreft echt precies hetzelfde. Het is zowel confronterend en hard als grappig. Dus je weet je geen, dit voelt ongemakkelijk. En dat kunnen ze allebei heel erg goed. En dat heeft Ronelde echt ook nog meer uitgebreid. En dat is heel duidelijk in die laatste bundel. En ook die bundel daarvoor eigenlijk, Hammy. En het is natuurlijk fantastisch om dat te mogen aanschouwen van dichtbij. En het was toen echt gewoon aanschouwen en lezen. Dat was nog voordat ik gevraagd werd om het werk te vertalen. Dus dat was toen gewoon als lezen. Dat ik dacht van wauw, dit is echt onwijs goed dit.
Ja, nee, dat vind ik heel fijn om te horen ook van jou. Hoe je haar werk hebt zien ontwikkelen. Maar ook met al die elementen. Dus het is nog ambivalenter geworden. Het is altijd confronterend en grappig en hard en direct. Daar hou ik ook heel erg van. Maar ik ben ook heel erg benieuwd, zeker de laatste tijd ben ik heel erg benieuwd geworden hoe dat is om werk te vertalen. Hoe was dat voor jou om haar werk te vertalen?
Ja, ook weer. Ja, ik werd daarvoor gevraagd en ik sprong daar heel erg onwetend in. Ik denk, ik ken dat Afrikaans, ik ken Ronelda wel, ik ken die poëzie, dus ik ga gewoon even zitten. Hier is het Afrikaans en dan maak je dan Nederlands van. Ja, dat valt tegen natuurlijk. Dat is hartstikke ingewikkeld om dat te doen. Dat is echt, ik weet wel dat het een vak is natuurlijk. Dat wist ik al als redacteur bij de Bezige Bij, waar ik met vertalers had gewerkt, die met Brodsky werkte bijvoorbeeld. Maar ik kan niet zeggen dat ik me daarover verkeken heb. Maar het was wel veel lastiger. Ook juist omdat het een taal is die ik zo goed begrijp en dan niet alleen grammaticaal, syntactisch, maar ik denk ook wel met het hart begrijp. Dus dan verwacht je dat je dat ook heel makkelijk kan omzetten in het Nederlands. Maar omdat het ook een heel eigen idioom is, en dan ook nog het Afrikaans waarin Ronelda schrijft, met veel Engels natuurlijk en veel slang en straattaal. Ja, hoe zet je dat in het Nederlands om? Dat was echt wel een kwestie. Dat is echt een keuze die je daar maakt. En ik heb gekozen ervoor om haar taal gewoon te zien als een taal. En niet als iets curieus en exotisch. Het hoor je wel eens van, er moet meer Engels in. Maar dan krijg je een soort Nederlandse millennial die hiphop praat in het Nederlands. En dat heeft helemaal niets meer te maken met de leefwereld waarin die poëzie ontstaat. Maar dat was bijvoorbeeld echt wel, dat was moeilijk om daar een toon in te vinden. Dus wel heel spreektalig, maar ook niet te gewild spreektalig, zodat het geforceerd is. Ik wil echt wel dienend vertalen en niet met mijn vertaling op de voorgrond gaan staan. Alles die dingen, die kwamen erbij, terwijl ik dat van tevoren niet verwacht had. Dat was echt interessant. Je gaat zitten, je denkt, ik ga gewoon vertalen. Maar dat was niet het geval.
Echt. Nee, dus het is eigenlijk veel... Want waar is het iets technisch voor jou om goed te vertalen? Of is het meer... ligt het meer aan de context? Dus dat je je in kan leven in de context? Of is het echt technisch werken?
Het is heel technisch, merk ik. Ja, die context die komt vanzelf. En anders heb ik altijd Ronelda om natuurlijk aan te vragen. Dus dat lukt wel. Maar het is vaak de technische oplossing. Hè? Van hoe vertaal ik dit? Je kunt er, dat doe je natuurlijk niet, maar je kunt er Haags van maken of Amsterdams of zo. Maar dat slaat ook helemaal nergens op. Dus het is een hele technische aanpak. Dat vraagt wel wat van je. En gelukkig zijn daar meelezers en helpt de uitgeverij ook. Het is niet makkelijk, maar het is wel fantastisch om te doen. Ik ben blij dat ik deze vier bundels heb mogen vertalen. Zo zie ik het een beetje. Ik vind het echt een hele grote eer. Echt een hele grote eer.
En wat doe je dan als je er niet uitkomt?
Huilen ten eerste. Dan mail ik Ronelda. Dat heb ik ook in een essay een keer geschreven. Maar dat zijn die ervaringen die je dan hebt in poëzie, die je als je 80 bent nog kunt navertellen. Dat was een lang gedicht uit Hammy, die ik vertaalde, een van de laatste gedichten, heel erg close to home, waarin de verteller met haar moeder in de auto zit op weg naar het ziekenhuis. Ze zegt, niet doodgaan, hè? Nog niet doodgaan. En ik kende dat gedicht. Het is dan iets dat je gewoon leest als een lezer, een paar keer, en je vindt het prachtig. En toen ging ik het vertalen. En dat is toch een veel intensere vorm van lezen. En ik kreeg het echt tijdens het vertalen, kreeg ik het gewoon te kwaad. Dat heb ik toen ook daarna aan Aronelda geschreven. Should I gedicht het mijn rechter laat, hel. En ja. Toen schreef zo, dat vond ik zo, ik zal het nooit vergeten, die mail. Toen zei, ja, Nathan, die is nou hartstikke jaloers. Hè. Ik ben nou hartstikke trots, want ik heb jou laten huilen. Nou wil hij jou ook laten huilen met zijn poëzie. Dat was voor mij zo'n mooi moment, want het ging zowel over het inhoudelijke aspect als het feit dat zij gewoon echt bezig zijn met kunst. Dus dat het ook constructies zijn. Ik ga nou iets proberen te maken wat nog dat kan overtreffen. Dat vond ik zo ontzettend gaaf om te lezen. En ook heel typerend voor hoe zij werken ook. Het is een lekkere competitie waarschijnlijk tussen die twee thuis. Maar ja, ik vraag dan als ik er niet uitkom en je probeert het weer. Je moet dan denk ik ook altijd tijd nemen om het weer rustig te lezen. Dus je legt het even naast je neer. Dan neem je het een paar dagen later weer op. Dan zie je het wat beter. Maar je moet wel geduld hebben als je het niet snapt. Even de tijd nemen.
En denk je dat het heel erg helpt dat jij zelf dichter bent? Of staat het juist in de weg?
Weet ik niet. Okay. Weet ik niet. Het is vaak gevraagd, dat weet ik niet eigenlijk. Er zijn natuurlijk zat hele goede vertalers die niet zelf schrijven. Of die proza schrijven dan misschien. Dus ik weet niet of dat echt een link hoeft te zijn. Ja. Ik kan me voorstellen dat het in de weg kan staan ook zelfs. Omdat je zelf een bepaalde poëtische voorkeur hebt. En dan ga je het in die trant vertalen. Maar dat is mij nog niet overkomen, gelukkig. Maar het kan zonder, denk ik. Ja. Makkelijk.
Dat denk jij. Maar dat weet jij natuurlijk niet. Want je bent wie je bent. Je bent de dichter. Dus.
Ja, daar kan ik niks aan doen inderdaad. Nee.
Nee, dank je wel, Alfred. Ik vind het echt geweldig dat je dit doet. En dat jij onderdeel van het netwerk van Ronelda, die ervoor zorgt dat wij steeds meer mooie dichtbundels krijgen en steeds meer over en van Ronelda kunnen lezen. Dus echt geweldig. Echt super dat je er bent. Toen ik jullie voor het eerst zag hier in het scherm, dacht ik meteen van wat mooi om te zien dat jullie elkaar kennen. Dus de herkenning zie je meteen. Dat is echt heel cool om te zien. Dus dank je wel, Alfred.
Graag gedaan.
So Ronelda, I was just asking Alfred if he thinks that his being a poet makes a difference in his ability to translate. And he said, I don't know. Of course he doesn't know, because he doesn't know what it's like to not be himself. I wonder if you have a vision on this. Do you think that the fact that he's a poet helps him?
I definitely think that it helps. I think that it's not so much that he's a poet, but it's that he is Alfred, and he's a very specific type of writer. And he understands sort of my work in a way that a writer can only understand it. And it's been very easy for me to communicate things with him. You know, I tried to. I was very nervous about, you know, Chinatown, because unlike the other books, it does contain a lot of sort of very specific context-based phrases and words. And I remember telling my friend Anna Marie, who read the manuscript before it got published, and she said, "Don't worry, Alfred's basically South African. He's gonna know." And it is. You know, for me, it's a very special sort of relationship to have. That I can literally, I have no concerns when with the translations. Because I read his work, and I just know his sensibilities, and he understands the South African context. He is very sensitive to that, and. I remember a couple of years back, someone was sort of asking me about translations and the fact is a man translating a woman's work. And I remember just getting so upset. I was like, no, he's not a man, he's Dutch. And, you know, them freaking out and I was like, just leave Alfred alone. So I become very defensive when I talk about, you know, him translating my work. And so it's like, leave, you know, he knows what he's doing. I just know he knows what he's doing, even though I don't understand Dutch properly. And so for me, it's a very, I mean, just now listening to the conversation of us knowing each other the long time that, you know, this has been coming. And so I'm very grateful to have Alfred as my translator.
Yeah, well, it sounds like it's, you know, you really, it's like you found something that works and nobody should dare, you know, question this.
No, yeah, it's not so much that, you know, no one should dare. I just feel like as a writer, you do, there's very few people you can actually connect with and write with and work with and feel really, really confident. You know, whenever I have to do collaborative projects with people, I'm always concerned that, you know, what if, you know, I don't like what this person is doing, how do you communicate that? Because artists, you know, have egos and it's always an issue. And so for me, I feel very lucky that I have a translator that I can relate to and that understands my work, that I'm not, you know, I have no concerns over. So that's an important role that he plays in my work as a writer, you know.
Yeah. No, that's a really, really well put. Now, I have this wonderful book here that I think a lot of people who are watching have as well. Or if they don't have, they really should get, because it has a lot of your, no longer latest, right? But a lot of your, for us, latest work in it. And it is such, I would say beautiful, because I feel beautiful is a complex word. It's such beautiful work. And it's autobiographical. Can you tell us what it is? What is this? What is Chinatown about for you?
Well, I think that it's just about sort of a very interesting and sort of influential and important part of my journey as a person. And when I write poetry collections, I tried, except for the first book, but the other books were all sort of theme based, and I try to focus on that and sort of, you know, I approach it like a musician would approach an album. You make music, you write certain songs that fits a theme and tells a story as a whole, and even though it's all these individual pieces. So for me, Chinatown was about, you know, just my own experiences and dealing with violence, dealing with, you know, just cultural and trauma, but also because I was doing my master's and I had to write the thesis, and you know, I just decided I was going to focus on patriarchy and feminism because it seems like sort of an obvious topic for me, because that's what, you know, my work is about. And so I found it really in the males in my world, in my upbringing, in my background, and examining all these, the impact and the implications of these complex relationships that sort of defined my upbringing. And so I wanted to write about that and really sort of just focus on that. So Chinatown is just sort of a story about a person explaining all these different ways of dealing with just unnatural and violent culture that, you know, you're just trying to get through. So that's, yeah. I guess that's what it means for me.
Because, I don't like talking in these terms about, well, in South Africa, you know, when it comes to sexual violence, it's one of, I think it's still the top country, the leading country in sexual violence. and reading your work, you really see how normal this unnatural thing is, right? So it's normal in the sense that it happens so much, but nobody seems to be able to talk about it, really. Your voice is the only voice that seems to be talking about it. The others are just sort of glossing over it. Is that...
Well, I don't think so. I think that there's definitely, in South Africa especially, a lot of other writers writing about these things and writing about it in different ways. And, you know, we have a very... The culture is very sort of, especially this generation of women, are very outspoken about things, and so this is a constant sort of conversation that we've been having over the past few years. So it's not, for me, this is, you know, it might not be as bad as it is in other countries, but I feel like the conversation that we are having, you know, everybody should be having, and it's obviously always a thing of looking at a country that already has so many problems, and so it's easy sort of to single out, you know, what is the worst thing that's happening. But for us in South Africa, I think that especially women, especially writers, especially people in this industry, it's really they are doing amazing work in speaking out against gender-based violence, against you know, the systems that are protecting this culture of violence against women. So I'm definitely not the only person doing that. I think that you know, there are many who's gone before me who's done this, and just the culture in South Africa is especially like the woman, as we've always had a very profound and heard voice, you know, and it's always for generations they've had to fight for keeping that voice, and it just sort of moves on to the next generation. Yeah. And if you look at the history, the woman's role in the struggle against apartheid, I mean, it's very important, and that's also something that we have to keep talking about, you know. Yeah. The violence is a social aspect to it, but there's other things as well.
I guess what I meant with the only voice is not that you're the only voice in South Africa, but in your book. So I was looking for a poem that I could use to, because what you do in your book is you actually, at least what I hear, what I read, is you do a really interesting thing with the silences of others. So for instance, in Contra 30, your mother confronts your father, and then he says he won't do it again, and then you know, Zucht, you know, these sort of, and I just could really recognize this, because I, you know, I find it really special how you did this, because I also come from a context where this happens so often, so much incest, but we don't use the language of incest, so much violence, we don't use the language of violence. We are also still, we are yet in Ghana, right, in the West Africa, we are yet to start talking about this properly. But your poems bring some of these issues. You clarify so much of what it is that we're doing, how we're moving around these sensitive topics, where it's indeed, it happens so often, and so because of this frequency, it's normal, but it is so abnormal, so unnatural that these things are happening, and we don't know how to talk about it. So your mother says, he won't do it again. That was it.
Yeah. Yeah, I think for me it was I knew by then, by my teenage years, that I knew that what speaking out meant. I knew that this is not a problem that was going to be solved. No one was going to come and save me, and you know, the bad people would go to jail and would live a, you know, a happy life. I understood that, but I felt like that I couldn't keep it to myself. I couldn't just not, it would be, I mean, I didn't live with my parents as a very young child. So I grew up in a very sort of my grandparents, where these two old people and a baby, and they raised me. And then I moved in with my parents when I was a lot older. So this was very, the culture that I got to see in Cape Town was very unusual to me, because no one wanted to be who they were. They weren't themselves. They were sort of mean. Everybody was mean, and that sort of just that social setting just sort of confused me as a child. And so I've always been trying to fight against that. So I would be different, but in a very sort of normal and healthy way. And so for me, telling my mother something that my father is doing was the same as, you know, speaking out against, I don't like, you know, this food, and I prefer this food. So it was normal for me to voice my feelings. And telling my mother that was more a way of making her aware that I was aware, that she was aware. So it wasn't the thing of I knew you knew, I know you know things, I know you're being quiet, but I'm just letting you know that I know you know, and this is a problem. And let that sit on your conscience for, you know, for whatever. And now you have to deal with this, because as long as I stay quiet, no one's going, everybody's going to pretend that it doesn't exist, but I'm going to keep talking about it so you know it exists. And you also have to deal with this. You know, you also have to feel guilty and shame and all those things that I'm experiencing. So for me, it was never a case of I want to speak out and really, really change things. I was just like, I'm not going to sit and suffer in silence. Everybody's going to suffer with me. You know, it was a way of not hiding, you know, yeah, the truth. And you know, we were all going to have to deal with this at some point. And I realized very young that I was going to be the one that had to deal with it. It was no one else was going to come and do that for me.
Yeah. No, I think in that sense, it goes back to what Alfred was saying about being direct and confrontational, and also the authenticity with which you have developed and nurtured a voice that, you know, you do it, you do your...
Dames en heren, zoals u misschien gemerkt zult hebben, hebben we een beetje problemen met de techniek, een kleine storing. We gaan nu snel door naar een van de onderdelen die sowieso gepland waren. Ronelda zal voordragen uit eigen werk.
Okay. Chinatown Daddy. My past strength lends a sophisticated use and tone projection. Dat mens hulle suit bykies middel knop vastmaak en hulle opstaan agter hulle desks. Sluit, hulle gaan nie nou meer verder die detectives vraag beantwoord nie. My past style, grey and black exploitation films in The Invisible Sketch of the Prong Gang. Volg leftovers van die Witmanse toxic masculinity. Hy is trauma's experimental phase. Sy legacy gaan wees Witmanlikheid. Die always a bridesmaid vir die bride van Wit Patriark. Sy oor bly sad, grootste punte in die klas uitgelees. Klas is Roman Polanski. Omring met oumans, strijk draaik om en vraag. It to that. Sy favorite plek om is Chinatown, van hy relate met die fake wealth, die shiny cup wat jou oor brand in business.
Yes, ik ben er. Sorry about that. We all thought that this would happen in South Africa, but over and over again, we see that we have the same. So, apologies. I don't know what happened, but everything suddenly shut off. Okay. Thank you so much. And my apologies for suddenly disappearing. It was beyond my control. We can't control everything. Ronelda, I don't even remember what I was trying to say, but I just really appreciate your voice. I think that's what I was trying to say, that it's so direct and confronting, and it I think it helps us to deal with such complex situations like the COVID crisis, but also sexual violence and sexual violence in families. Can you tell us a little bit about the themes in Chinatown?
I think for me the focus in Chinatown is obviously it's the my experience with thinking about patriarchy from a different perspective. I think that looking at this terrible sort of character, my father, who is in some ways a victim of sort of general white patriarchy, and is just copying these toxic behaviors that, you know, interpreting that sort of just how bad masculinity is in society in general, and what it causes and what it creates. So it was very difficult for me to as a sort of a complete human being in a society that, you know, is also a result of whatever, you know, complicated things he experienced in his own life. And I wanted to write about that. And I also wanted to write about white feminism, you know, as in the same way as these sort of two forces that surrounds my experience as a black person in just in general in the community, and how we are, you know, feminists, and but there's this one part that is not quite doing what it's supposed to be doing, you know, and the intention is there, but also especially within Afrikaans, in Afrikaans context, it's important for me to, it was important for me to sort of examine my role in it and my experiences with it.
Yeah.
And also to address it just, you know, by writing about it.
Yeah. Are there themes of love? Would you say there are themes of love in Chinatown?
I would say no.
Alfred would say yes.
Yeah, Alfred would say yes, because yeah, he's up. No, I would say I try to write about myself as a whole person in different experiences that I experience. So it's not just this tragic side of myself, you know. I also have positivity and good things that I appreciate. But you know, I did say this before, that I find it very difficult and uncomfortable to talk about, you know, write about love or write about my daughter, because these are things that I cherish very close to me. And it's like, I've realized now after attempting, you know, so many poems about Seymour that, you know, I'll just leave the poetry to her. She can write about me and complain about me when she's grown up, because I'm enjoying this too much. You know, I'm enjoying this, just our experience, you know, and our connection. But yeah, as a writer, I feel like, you know, I sometimes have to go there. I mean, you know, everybody always makes fun of me and say, I have one feeling and I hate feelings, because it's true. Because I think it just complicates things that I can't think clearly about if I feel too much. So I want to sort of analyze and be honest and be clear. And, you know, when I have to think about writing a poem about my daughter, I'm just, how can you not be, you know, How can it not be a mess if you you're thinking about something that you're feeling at the same time?
Yeah. And okay, I think I understand this. So maybe you can, I don't know if you'd already started when I suddenly disappeared, but you had? Okay, and then I took you back. I'm sorry about that. I should have just asked you, but perhaps we can go to your reading.
So I'm going to continue. Bamboo. A drama demon sus gouden bamboo earrings in a Missy Elliott video. Ek sit en drink gin and tonic saam met Amut en sy wys my wie wie is. Ek gee my demons troetelname en treat hulle goed, soos 'n mom in a blind spot. Ek soek nie 'n plek langs die tafel nie. Ek soek nie 'n plek langs 'n Women's Enfranchisement Act table wat in 1930 geset was vir white women only nie. Hou julle tafel. Ons maak vier buitekant. Senretsu Kyaku. Ek probeer van jongs af om die stryd te narrow te redefine. My childhood idols was Chun-Li en Storm. Tot ek my aunties in dam speel het en my niggie in die pad sien beklei het, toe word hulle my idols. Niemand is cooler as 'n colored vrou met 'n vuil kyk nie. Die type van coolness wat net aan ons behoort, soos boyscuts, piercings en butterfly tattoos, soos groen rollers en Adidas slides met sokkies, soos cheap underwear en dier tekkies, soos min kos en klomp engine. My poems is nie confessions nie. Net 'n wit man kan dink 'n vrou wat haar kop in 'n oond drink is. Let me start again. Net 'n wit man kan dink 'n vrou wat haar kop in die oond drink. Druk is sexy. As ek dink aan Sylvia Plath, dink ek aan Ted Hughes se birthday letters, Jeremiah's stupid song Birthday Sex en 'n birthday koek wat half gebrand is. Dan weet ek nie of ek moet lag of huil vir die TV. Ek voel fokol vir 'n wit vrou wat mooi gedigte geskryf het in 1960s Amerika. En ek voel nog minder vir een wat gedurende apartheid mooi gedigte geskryf het. My literêre heroes wen nie generaal Hertzog pryse nie. Ek was nog nooit enige iemand se nooi of madam nie. My poems is nie vir 'n suffragette nie. My poems is vir die anties in die kombuis. My poems is vir die swart en bruin laities in 'n klas vol wit kinders. Ek is die meid se kind en nou is ek groot. Ek exchange my ma se as vir gunpowder vir die next generation, sodat hulle armed kan wees. Hulle gaan ons weer in ons rug te skiet terwyl ons in vrees weghardloop nie. Red Virgin. Al die hardcore wit meisies wat ek ken, draai eventually hulle pa of oupa se suits. Dit begin by die eerste pixie cut en die radicalization van hulle eating habits. Die Hannah Arendt Plath romance, die cute mixed babies by die Sankara lookalike, die blog vlog en die Simone Weil quote tattooed in Bookman old style. All sins are attempts to fill voids. En net so val selfvergifnis in hulle rhythmless laps, soos 'n nuwe demokrasie se equity policy. Laat die wit meisies huil. Die purity van die wêreld is in die secret formule van wit meisie trane. My trane is swaar en besoedel. Wit meisies huil as hulle tete te klein is. Ek huil sonne sound met droë oë, soos iemand wat haar trane syfer het drou. Wit meisies se bloed is valuable, soos ancient Hungarian water, terwyl myne vas sit in die krake van crime scenes. zijn die lumen al om al die blueprints te zien. Miss Militancy. Ik leef al lang genoeg om te weten, integrity is voor mensen wat denk al is beter als ander. Ik heb lang al mijn virtues getraind voor de freedom van mijn vices.
Nee, nog niet.
Ja, ik heb hem. Well, thank you so much, Ronelda, it was really great to listen to you.
Reading your poems to us.
And it's also great to recognize the language.
And there I see that there's a question coming in.
It says, zie je jouw schrijven ook als een vorm van activisme om anderen op te roepen om zich uit te spreken over wat er in hen omgaat of waar men mee worstelt? So is your, well, I don't need to translate because you speak Afrikaans. Do you see your writing as a type of activism?
The short answer is no. I think that, you know, to be an activist, that is a full-time sort of commitment, life commitment. I write poetry to express myself, but also to make readers think and feel, I hope. You know, that's the only form of activism that I feel like I do. I don't think it's so much a political thing. It's more of an emotional connection to things that you can interpret in your own way and experience in your own life. I know that books help me deal with things and see the world in a different way. So hopefully, you know, poetry does that to people.
Yeah. I just, you know, thank you so much for that, because you just do things on your terms. And if it becomes activism, that's what it becomes. But you do things on your terms, and that is so valuable for so many people, millions of people who are also dealing with the same things. So much of what you write about is so recognizable. I don't know if there are more questions. It's possible to send in questions through the chat. I see there's another question that has come in. In het Nederlands. Hoe zorg je ervoor dat een tekst niet blijft steken in activisme? Hoe zorg je ervoor dat wat je wil zeggen poëzie wordt?
Oké.
That's the question, yeah.
I think I understood the question.
The question is, how do you make sure that your poetry, that your text doesn't become activism? How do you make sure that what you're saying is poetry and not like an activistic pamphlet, let's say?
Yeah, I think that is an important question. I think that as the culture we live in today, the times we are creating in, I think that artists do get sort of swept away with the narrative and the time, because there's so many things that are sort of value added onto certain things, on popularity, on having a voice, on being, you know, right, being on the right side of things, being on the right side of the argument. I think that my only concern has always been just writing and literature. And if it happens to have an impact, I think then that's fine. But for you as a writer, you shouldn't be, that should be the last thing you think about, you know. If you are creating something, if you're writing poetry, just focus on that. You can't really help how the world perceives you or how people see you. I mean, as a black woman, you know, there's already these tons of labels attached to me. Just my presence is attached to, if I say something, then I'm outspoken. You know, I'm not actually, you know, if I have an opinion on things, I'm being an activist. If I call out, you know, wrong things in my culture, or in my world, or in my surroundings, then I become this. And just, I think that as a writer, you just need to separate yourself from that world and realize that is not the reality that that everybody exists in, and don't get caught up in it, because like I said before, activism is a full-time job. If you weren't going to be an activist, you have to dedicate your life to it. Mm-hmm. And I don't do that. I write, and I decide what is poetry, because I write the poetry. You know, I'm in control of that aspect of my creating and my process. So yeah, my advice would be just don't get caught up in it. You know, don't get carried away with wanting to be popular, or wanting to be right, or wanting to be a voice for the voiceless and stuff like that, because we all carry those labels, and it just depends how you interpret it and how you internalize these things.
Yeah, no, thank you so much for that. And maybe before I go to the next question, I want to add something to this question about poetry, because I see a juxtaposition here, where in Chinatown, you write about not the beautiful things in life, right? These pretty difficult things that happen, but you write poetry. So, and poetry for me is about beauty. So can you tell us a little bit about, maybe that helps with answering this question as well, on activism? So not so much activism, but like the ugly side of life, let's say, or the difficult things in life, but then in a poetic way, how does that help you? How does that work for you?
I think that, you know, beauty is open for, you know, how you define it. I think that everybody defines it differently. I think that there's no one that I know that defines what we know as poetry as beauty. You know, it's maybe complicated, it's nice, but I don't know anyone who would describe it like that. And for me, it is, I find beauty in things that, you know, are honest, and things that are sort of clear. And I just sort of love when people can be the authentic selves. So that's, I find that beautiful. And for me, writing about things and knowing that this is something that someone has overcome, you know, that's beautiful to me. I mean, the subject, I mean, life is ugly always, you know. It's not, I don't look for things to define. So the beauty of poetry is open to interpretation. So yeah. It's not something straightforward, and it's also sort of I think that it's sort of it adds that sort of exclusivity to it, that somehow you have to write a certain way to be perceived as a real poet, or this is poetry. And you know, a couple of weeks ago, someone did ask me, you know, but how do I know it's poetry? It's because, you know, I say so. I'm writing it, so, you know, I get to define it. And I think that it's also that, you know, it's been a cultural thing that is defined by sort of middle class white men, and that time, you know, has passed. So I think everybody gets to interpret things their own way and experience things and define it for themselves.
Yeah, thank you so much for that, because it goes back to the idea of an authentic voice and just cutting yourself off all those expectations and just finding your voice and being yourself. We're moving on to another question for you, Ronelda and Alfred. Hoe verschillend is de beeldvorming van Ronelda's poëzie in Zuid-Afrika tegenover Nederland en Vlaanderen in Alfred's vertaling? So how different is beeldvorming? You know what beeldvorming is? Representation? Is that representation? I guess so.
Imaging.
Go ahead.
Well, I'm not living in the Netherlands, so I don't know how her work is coming across there. I do know, that's all I can say about this myself, is that, well, Ronelda now the other day said that she was so surprised, happily surprised obviously, and overwhelmed as well with the response in the Netherlands, and also surprised with the positive response, because there was no sort of critique about the content.
Yeah.
which obviously here is a bit different. Is if she reads for certain audiences, obviously, this poem about, you know, Ingrid Jonker and well, some people of the establishment here, obviously, they don't get angry, but they may be agitated or something, and so that maybe she's more like an itch here than she is in the Netherlands. I'm not sure, but I just know that Ronaldo was very surprised, happily surprised by the overwhelming response from readers over there. He said, "Where aren't they mad or something at what I write?" And yeah, maybe the Netherlands is very woke, and we just don't realize it.
You're the first person in the world who said this.
Yeah. But obviously, especially among young people here, she also has a great readership. And I think also a lot of, Ronaldo can tell, obviously she knows better, but also a lot of older critics or more from the establishment, also, she's really acknowledged here. And a lot of young writers at the moment who emerge are very, they're sort of seen as a rescue even for poetry in general, and also in other languages like Koleka Putuma. So there's a whole new buzz around poetry here as well. So, but this is just the anecdote that I always keep remembering. They say, wow, those people in the Netherlands, they really, really take this. And they're not even mad. Yeah, it's nice.
We are woke in the Netherlands, everybody.
Yes.
Ronelda, did you want to respond to this question as well?
Yeah, thanks for telling my business, Alfred. I mean, yeah, it is strange because I mean I'm used to being someone that somehow sort of causes a bit of, you know, issue in locally, in Afrikaans, but I think it's just, again, it's interpretation. I think there are many readers who are very still very defensive about issues within the literature. And once anyone is critical of it, you know, you do get a little bit of, you know, backlash for that. But for me, I think that I was surprised at the response in the Netherlands for Chinatown, mainly because my feeling when writing Chinatown was exactly that. I wanted it to be sort of inspiring and enjoyed, and also, you know, something that people could relate to, and just learning that now that people relate to it, I think that is the biggest compliment, you know, any writer can get, that there are people who's like, I understand this, I know this, I felt this, you know. So that's, for me, is more important than anything. And also in South Africa, within Afrikaans, you know, many young people, they relate to it in that way. And that's always been special to me, that you know, to have in real time, a direct, like, conversation with people who are now starting out writing in the same. You know, this helped me to, you know, articulate certain things that I've wanted to. So, yeah, that's the biggest compliment to me.
Well, thank you so much. Thank you so much, Ronelda and Alfred. Thank you also for allowing me to call you by your first names. And thank you for speaking to us so openly and sharing your perspectives and your journey on this. But most of all, I want to thank you, Ronelda, for Chinatown, because this is a book of poetry that you read from front to back. You can pick it up and read the whole thing. You don't necessarily have to start in the middle and then move around it. And I really appreciate that. I appreciate the recognition. I appreciate recognizing the voice and the image. And I just really appreciate your work. I hope that one day in a post-COVID future, you will be brought here and we can meet each other and we can really feel your words as you speak them. I mean, it's working this way as well, but it really can't replace a human connection. So thank you, and thank you both. Thank you, Alfred, for being the bridge that allows more of us to relate and understand and connect and ultimately heal by recognizing ourselves in Ronelda's work. So Thank you so much. I would like to, I'm not the boss. Eh? I'm just, it's just a moment for me. So I have to give the voice back to the boss. Anjali, please take us home. Close it off, close the circle off for us. And thank you also for the opportunity to do this. I enjoyed it.
Thank you, Alma. Thanks.
Thank you.
Nou, ik heb de eer om jullie ontzettend te bedanken voor een geweldig gesprek. Ik heb genoten. Ik heb aan mijn stoel gekluisterd gezeten. Chinatown zal blijven in de zin van dat inderdaad er nog meer over gesproken gaat worden. Nog meer gelezen gaat worden. Nog meer gesprekken over gevoerd gaan worden. En daar zullen wij graag steeds bij zijn. In Nederland misschien, als het weer mogelijk is. Alfred, jij hartelijk dank voor jouw weer inzichtsvolle bijdrage ook. En overigens allebei ook bedankt voor de humor die er in het gesprek zat. Dat vond ik ook wel een hele interessante. En Ama, last but not least, jij ontzettend bedankt voor je bezielende leiding, je mooie vragen en je enthousiasme. Dus bedankt en we zien jullie uiteraard een keer weer terug, maar voor nu moet ik even afsluiten met hele saaie opmerkingen en zo. Goed, even praktisch. Chinatown is dus verschenen bij, de vertaling van Chinatown is verschenen bij uitgeveraar Podium, uiteraard door Alfred Schoffer vertaald. Podium is hier in Nederland ook de uitgever van andere Afrikaanse, Zuid-Afrikaanse dichters. Zoals Ankie Kroog, Breiten Breitenbach en Ingrid Jonker. En het bijzondere aan Podium is dat ze, als ze een poëziebundel laten vertalen, dat er dan altijd links de Afrikaanse tekst staat en rechts de Nederlandse tekst. Zodat dus de lezer ook beide teksten en beide gevoelens in de teksten kunnen meekrijgen. Nou, koop dat boek zou ik zeggen. Liefst bij uw lokale boekhandel. Maar als het niet anders kan, kunt u het ook via allerlei geëikte andere kanalen kopen. Maar ik ben voor de lokale boekhandel. En in diezelfde lokale boekhandel zijn natuurlijk ook de boeken van Alfred Schaffer zelf te koop. Zoals vorig jaar verschenen en met de Herman de Koninkprijs. Oh Johan, win jij veel prijzen? De kroonde Wie was ik? Strafregels. Lokale boekhandel. Ik wil graag hier de taal heel graag bedanken, want zij hebben ervoor gezorgd dat wij dat in gezamenlijkheid dit soort dingen kunnen organiseren. Dus bedankt Taalunie. En dan kon ik meteen de aflevering aan. Die is volgende maand op donderdag 24 juni en dan is Marita van der Vijver te gast bij Boeken uit het Huis. En van der Vijver maakt het furore met even intelligente als speelse romans als Griet schrijft een sprookie, Die dingen van een kind en Die blauw van onthaal. Maar Marita zal met Francine Maas in gesprek gaan over hopelijk het eerste deel van haar memoires, Een baaienlang brief aan mijn dochter. Ik dank u ontzettend voor het kijken en het luisteren en tot volgende maand. Dank u wel.